Do not labor for the food that perishes. When we review our lives, it becomes evident that all too often we labor for food that instead of nourishing, that robs us of life, present life, as well as putting in jeopardy eternal life for the future. So if we would ask ourselves, well, how are we doing? It's not our intention to labor for worthless food, but at the end of every day, it seems that's where we've been gorging ourselves. How are we doing? Well, not too well. When we hear the word of God, we always divide that word between law and gospel. This portion of the gospel reading this morning is definitely law. It's the will of God. Do not gorge yourself on worthless food. Well, when we hear that word of law, what's its corresponding gospel message? Does God just leave us lingering in that sense of guilt? Or is there any good news in the word of God for us? When we experience guilt, the corresponding gospel message is the one that we heard earlier today. By virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, I announce the grace of God unto all of you, and I forgive you. Anytime we hear in Scripture a word of law that evokes from us a sense of guilt, listen longer to hear the good news of forgiveness. The only reason God brings us to the point of guilt is to prepare our hearts to hear the good news that while we were yet sinners, God loved us and gave His only Son to suffer and die that we might have forgiveness and be restored in our relationship with Him and call Him Father. But this isn't the only word of God that we hear when we look at Scripture. There is a second sense of law gospel that we hear, and that's a word of law that drives us to despair. Despair is the result of us living less than in the abundant life as the consequence of things over which we exert any control. Been there? Disease, famine, hurricane, rebellious neighbors leads us to despair. Well, when we look at Scripture, we're going to find several people whose lives were brought to the brink of despair. We remember Peter, after denying Jesus three times, goes out and weeps bitterly. We remember Judas, who goes out and in guilt and despair hangs himself. The result of despair in our lives leads us to do all kinds of ungodly things to ourselves and to one another. When we look at Scripture, we'll encounter the story of the widow of Nain. Nain, the city of pleasure. Jesus and his disciples were entering the village of Nain and encountered a funeral procession. The only son of a widow had died, and she was taking him and herself to that final resting place. For you see, in Jesus' day, women had no sense of identity or security apart from a man. That's why, remember, when Joseph found out that Mary was pregnant, what was he going to do? Send her back to her father. That was her source of identity. Who are you and your source of security? Well, walk in the footsteps then of that widow whose husband had died. Her primary sense of security and identity, who are you? Well, not only was her husband dead, but now her only son, her second source of identity and security, was dead. So she just as well be dead. Her sense of identity, security, meaning, and purpose were gone. Can you imagine that life of despair? What do you think were her options? Well, perhaps she had relatives and she could go beg, "Can I stay with you?" Perhaps she was one who would hang around the temple and ask for alms from Jews that came to worship. This life of despair for this woman of Nain, isn't that much different than what leads us all too often to a life of despair? Might be a medical diagnosis. What does the future hold? What hope is there? It might be a fractured and ruptured family when things just fall apart. What hope is there? Well, when we experience that despair and when we see it in the lives of Bible characters, where do we find the gospel? Where do we find the good news? Favorite chapter and verse in the Bible is John 10:10. "I've come that you might have life and life to its fullest." Despair robs us of life. Where's Jesus when I despair? Well, we know where he was in the story of the widow of Nain. He reaches out and says to the kid, "Get up." Restoring to this woman a sense of security, a sense of identity. And he does the same for us as he whispers in our ears, "I will never leave you or forsake you." This good news that nothing, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus is how a Christian responds to the temptations of the devil, the world, and your own flesh, to despair, to lose hope. And believe me, when you live with that confidence in your life, your neighbors will ask, "Where do you get that hope in light of all the suffering in your life?" Take the opportunity to point them to the Christ, the one who is well acquainted with suffering, the one who is well acquainted with the brink of despair, but the one who went in our place to Calvary to conquer sin, death, and the power of the devil. That's the second law gospel correlate. The third one, and if you're wondering what does this have to do with the gospel reading for the day, here it comes. Okay, the third one is the third expression of law, where we have every intention to obey. We hear the will of God. This do. Don't labor for worthless food. Right on. Okay. That's what I'm going to do. Some of us even work at putting together plans. This is the way I'm going to do it. And then, unfortunately, we form little groups, and we hold each other accountable. How are you doing? Okay. Well, when we do that, watch out, because it elicits from us either rebellion, "I'm going to quit the group, heck with it," self-righteousness, that's the Lutheran temptation, "Well, I'm doing pretty good, at least I'm doing better than most of you," or the third response is despair, "I've tried, but I keep failing, so I'm even going to give up." Well, this law of God that diagnoses our impotence left to ourselves, we can't. We've tried, we've resolved, we worked at, but at the end of every day, our pillows are wet with tears, recognizing that we have fallen far short. Well, what's the good news? The good news is not only does he forgive you and renew you, but he enables you. The good news is that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So you see, it isn't me doing it, but it's him doing it in me. In our baptism, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it's this Holy Spirit, excuse me, I forgot you were over there. It's this Holy Spirit that produces in us love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. It's this Holy Spirit that enables us to avoid all those things that pretend to be the bread of life and to cling to the one, the only one bread of life. Well, how does God the Holy Spirit do this? Lutherans talk about the work of the Holy Spirit in the context of the phrase, the means of grace. How does God the Holy Spirit grace us? The first one is the Word of God, the gospel, this good news. So we encourage one another each day. The first thing you do after your cup of coffee is to open your portals of prayer and hear the Word of God. That's where you find the strength. That's where God enables you to take up your cross and to follow Him. That's where God enables you to resist the temptation to despair. The second one is the daily remembrance of our baptism. This good news that in baptism we have the washing of regeneration. We're born again. So Luther reminds us in the Catechism, the daily significance of such washing is every day we drown the old Adam and the new person in Christ comes forth. In my former years, I was a sixth grade teacher. Well, what do teachers use to start the school day? Well, devotions. We're a Lutheran school. We're going to have devotion. Well, what's the point of the devotion? Well, the point of the devotion is I got 36 sixth graders and I want to drown them all. Right? So that we all repented. And then I had 36 born again children of God. Ones, as I looked around the room, bore on their brow the seal of Him who died. So when it would come time to admonish, correct, rebuke, I had a choice. Do I want to apply or appeal to the old one we just tried to drown? Or am I going to appeal to this new person in Christ that God has blessed in my classroom? 98% of the time, it worked out really well. Every once in a while, I'd have to revert and deal with the one I thought I had drowned earlier that somehow had survived. But anyway, we all live in that grace of our baptism. The old Adam in us has been drowned. And every morning when you look in the mirror, you confess your sin. This is who I am and what I have done. And out of that good news then, that while we were yet sinners, God loved us, a new person comes forth, lives completely different. Your spouse will even recognize the difference. Your kids will recognize the difference. The third means of grace is one that we're going to celebrate shortly. Well, that's what he says, shortly. Third means of grace, and that's when he invites us to come and taste and eat of the bread of life, Holy Communion, where we receive his very body and his blood for the assurance of forgiveness and the strengthening of our faith. That Spirit works in that bread of life to assure of forgiveness and to renew, so that as we leave this place, we're no longer caught up in guilt, despair, or impotence, but we are ones who celebrate forgiveness, empowerment, and ultimate victory. The fourth means of grace is, well, Pastor, I've got this sin and my conscience will not let me go. I hear on Sunday morning you say generically, your sins are forgiven, but this sin weighs so heavy. Well, that's when you go to your pastor for private confession and absolution. And when you come, you're going to say, I don't feel forgiven. And your pastor is going to share with you the good news is your forgiveness is not dependent upon your feeling. Your forgiveness is dependent upon what Christ did on Calvary, whether you feel that way or not. Cling to that, and then you have hope. The fifth means that the Holy Spirit uses to enable us, to equip us, is this gathering together of brothers and sisters in Christ. Those of you that had the privilege of memorizing the explanation, the third article, the Apostles' Creed, celebrates the truth that the Holy Spirit calls, gathers, and enlightens. And it's in that gathering where he brings together the members of Trinity Evangelical Lutheran Church in Roselle to build one another up, to strengthen one another, to remind one another of God's great love in Christ. It's what we heard about in the epistle reading for this morning. How then shall we live? We live as a gathered people. Those are the means that the Holy Spirit uses to enable us to become all things through Christ, who strengthens us for life now and to eternity. I'm old enough to recognize the results in my life of neglecting those five, of being tempted to turn to that other food. And I thank God that by his grace, he continually calls me back, enlightens me with his gifts, gathers me together, and enables me then to live, not only now, but for eternity, to his glory and the benefit of my neighbors. In Christ's name, amen.